So welcome everyone. It's our week three, I believe. Is it three? Week three? I forgot week three or week four
of it's prayers. Week four.
Week four. Yeah. Okay. Four. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So week four today, and we have August 17, 1913. You know the prayer with us, and I would. As always, I would like all of you to just keep reflecting your sharing in the beginning, you know, one by one. Just please share how was it to go through the prayer, and were you able to find any connections between our day-to-day life and the prayer? Yeah. Would like to go first?
I will go, Monica.
Yes, Chitra ji.
Yeah. That addressing, no, that master of our life. That is my favorite prayer, actually. I used to address mother and Shedindo like that. Mother and yeah. Master of, yeah. Master, the first thing. And the next, when I have gone through this prayer, I thought, that you should not give much importance to your bodily thing, and also not about progress. And one question came to me, actually. That is a very thin line, no? Not giving much importance to body, but at the same time, you have to maintain the body to pursue in this path also, no? We have to maintain that, but we should not give much importance also for that bodily comforts and luxuries.
That thing
came to me, actually. Then about progress also, we can't remain tamasic, but at the same time, if we have to aspire, but there also that middle path we should follow, no? Actually.
Yes, yes.
These two things came to me, actually.
Yeah, beautiful. I think it's a very interesting point that you raised, because the way we live usually, we are usually obsessed by the world. And once we begin to walk on this path, even then, in many, many ways, we just continue that obsession. Like, you know, these many meditation hours I have done, you know, that obsession is continued. The variety of obsession has changed. First, it was a sansaric obsession, a worldly obsession. Now it has become a spiritual obsession. So nothing changed.
Okay.
You know, so also, you know, just say how we, you know, for example, if I'm having a headache, mm-hmm. Only when I'm having a headache do I realize I have a head. Mm-hmm. Only then this consciousness comes into picture. Oh my God, you know, the head is making its presence felt owing to the ache.
Okay.
But when everything is all right, we don't have any feeling, you know. You don't say shouting over the top of your voice that, you know, oh, I have a head which is doing fine, you know. I have a head which is doing fine. We don't do that. So when everything is in a balanced state, then we don't need any kind of obsession about it. So yes, you're right that we have to maintain a body just like we maintain a house, and we do that. But how we live is that we are usually just obsessed by our body or the mind or the feelings. That obsession is the biggest culprit which gives rise to all the problems and difficulties in our life.
Because sometimes I feel I don't want to go for any checkup and all, master checkup something.
Yeah.
If I go, no, I will get a lot of fear, actually, what the doctor will tell.
Yes, yes,
how
yes.
How it will go, yeah. That fear also should go, yeah.
Yeah, you know, Chitra ji, in this case, I would say that, you know, as long as you feel fine,
yeah,
yeah. As long as you feel right, that, you know, there is a rightness and ease in my body.
Yeah.
I think you can easily go by your instincts.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I have been doing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's
what I suffered doing. From cancer, and I have not done any checkups in years now. So I am prepared that, okay, you know, anything, any day, anything can happen. But first of all, I'll feel it in the body, right?
Correct.
So can we trust that instinct also, that the body will tell if there is anything wrong, and then I am ready to go for diagnostics.
Correct. That time, that fear should not be there. That time also we should surrender, no, completely.
When I'm going for diagnostics, you know, once I have surrendered the life to the divine, then only the divine needs to take care of the servant. Otherwise, if the divine decides, okay, time for the servant to go, that is his wish. My wish will not come in between. I will do what is required. And that's why it needs a lot of courage to even, you know, say it out. That yes, my wish doesn't matter. You decide.
Thank you.
Yeah. More thoughts on the prayers? Anyone?
Monica, I can share next.
Yes.
I wanted to, so every prayer of the mother, a lot of times the theme that comes to me again and again is that of surrender. So I'll read some lines here. Deliver those who are in this bondage, O Lord, even as those who are the slaves of passion. On the path that leads to thee, these obstacles are at once terrible and puerile. First she's saying that she's actually praying to Lord only and saying, deliver those of us who are in bondage. And even though they are in the worst kinds of bondages, and she is just, the prayer rises from her. And it just came to me that it's interesting that she's not saying that give them the determination to pull them out, pull themselves out or something. She's giving all of the sense of doership or, you know, the sense of any sense of something to do. She's just giving that to the Lord and saying, you deliver those who are in bondage. And then she says, how shall I describe that utter relief, that delightful lightness which comes when one is free from all anxiety for oneself, for one's life and health and satisfaction, and even for one's progress. And these lines are so beautiful because I know that everybody who is here at one point or the other must have had a glimpse of it. That when we have felt completely at peace and at rest, there really is no worry about our own present or future or past. So and she says even one's progress, you know, not even worried where I am and I'm at A and I want to be at B, C, D, you know, like nothing, absolutely nothing of that, no health, no nothing. And then last few lines I wanted to read, which is again so beautiful because it is like completely giving oneself and not holding any doubts about oneself and holding no doubts about the divine also. This relief, this deliverance thou has granted to me, O thou divine master, life of my life and light of my light.
Yeah.
It's so beautiful because, you know, like a lot of other texts like Upanishads also say that, no? Sight of my sight and hearing of my hearing and vision of my vision. So she says, life of my life and light of my light. O thou who unceasingly teaches me love and makes me know the purpose of my existence. So thank you for choosing this prayer. It was very beautiful.
Thank you for sharing. Beautiful. You know, that's really interesting. The one line that I that really struck me that you shared, you know, that even so in world also, when we are kind of troubled by the world and of relations and my own self, there also we are always trying to go from point A to point B. And if I continue the same pattern of behavior in yoga also, nothing has changed. You know, this experience happened, now I want to have another experience. You know, all this greed of filling up that void that we all feel within us, you know, that nothing has changed. We may even have a, mother says that spiritual ego is even a worse kind of an ego, because there you feel that you have got it, right? I am in a beautiful domain, I am in the spiritual domain, but there also the same rat race is going on. I'm wanting to kind of, you know, show others down and just move from one point to the other point.
Yeah, I felt like the subject of our fixations changes. Like instead of car, I want God. But our fixations and our, you know, a lot of times we remain pretty much, you know, we really preserve ourselves very well, I have to
You're
say.
You're so good at it. Yeah, really good at it. Yeah, that's true. Amazing. Yeah. You know, once somebody asked Osho that when I read your words, then rarely something happens. But when I am listening to you, then there are times when you know, something really drastic kind of some transformation happens, something really touches me deeply. Why is that? And Osho said that, you know, when you are reading, then you are who you are. And you will be interpreting through the glasses of the one who is reading. But when you are listening to me, then there are times jo it doesn't happen by your own doing. It just happens, you know, that you try to preserve yourself so, so much, preserve your identity. But when you are listening to me, it happens that many a times that the one who is listening is not there anymore. So he said that I enter you in that point where you allow yourself to dissolve. So that is really interesting on how we just keep on preserving our identity and maybe just giving it a different dress, you know, now a spiritual dress. And we feel that we have done something, we have achieved something in life and, you know, life is better than before, but it's the same game going on. Yes. Yeah. Yes, anyone else? Himanshi, Preeti?
Hi.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful prayer.
Mm.
And makes you think so much, actually. Just want to reflect so much. अभी एक्चुअली सुबह ये सब ऐसे ही सुनते मुझे आई वाज जस्ट रिमाइंडेड ऑफ हाउ आई हैव सीन बिफोर आई टॉक अबाउट माय सेल्फ बिकॉज वी डू एज व्हाट वी सी फ्रॉम आवर पेरेंट्स आई हैव हैड वेरी कंट्रास्ट सेट ऑफ पेरेंट्स लाइक माय पेरेंट्स एंड इन लॉज एंड हाउ माय फादर हैज बीन सो ऑब्सेस्ड विद हिज बॉडी हम अपने पेरेंट्स से ही सीखते हैं ना जैसे वो लोग बिहेव करते हैं तो हम लोग भी कुछ कुछ उन्हीं से सीखते हैं दे आर आवर फर्स्ट स्कूल सो अपने फादर की कुछ आदतें मैं अपने आप में देखती हूँ फिर मैं अपने इन लॉज से भी कुछ सीखा वो भी इतने ऑब्सेस्ड होते थे कि खाना कैसा होना चाहिए हमेशा प्रॉपर बैलेंस्ड डाइट हेल्दी डाइट एंड आई हैव गॉन थ्रू दैट फेज आल्सो आई हैव बीन ऑब्सेस्ड विद दैट एंड देन लर्न दैट मॉडरेशन इज द की एंड इतना टेंशन नहीं लेने का है You don't have to get so obsessed.
Yeah.
इतना अच्छा खाने के बाद भी जरूरी नहीं है कि हेल्थ रहेगी. माइंड इज सो ऑब्सेस्ड विद जस्ट ठीक चीज खाएं और इतनी क्वांटिटी खाएं, इसने बोला है उतना खाएं, यू नो, जस्ट सो स्ट्रिक्टली फॉलोइंग, यू नो, लाइक सम रूटीन एंड ऑल, नॉट टू टेक सो मच स्ट्रेस अबाउट इट. देन ऑल्सो सीन पीपल हु जो बिल्कुल अपना ध्यान नहीं रखते उनको भी देखा है. When I come to myself, हमने अपने आप को भागते ही देखा है बस सारे टाइम, यू नो, लाइक ऑल द टाइम वांटिंग टू जस्ट कीप डूइंग डूइंग डूइंग.
Yeah.
But we get this very just very glimpse of moments when we are like totally free and relaxed. होते हैं, but very rare and few, and otherwise either the body is running or the mind is running all the time. So this full prayer to sit, actually this contemplation on this is going to continue actually.
Yeah, true.
Thank you for bringing it up.
Yes, thank you. You know, this is very interesting. You know, it's when you said either the mind is running or the body is running, that's true. And I feel that, you know, it's not that to have a simple life does not mean, would not mean that we have a very easy life, you know, in the sense, when we say a simple life, it's the mind which is becoming simple. You know, the outer life will be maybe even more busier than the previous life, because now when you are ready, you know, the divine gives you more work, you know, because you are simple, you are uncomplicated. So you are allowed to even do like 24 hours of work, which you were doing earlier 5 hours of work. The thing is that when we talk about ease and relaxation in life, the point is that it's the mind, it's the state of being of my whole inner being that we talk about. Andar se halat kya hai, you know, am I simple in the mind? Am I uncomplicated in my feelings? And then I can even do more divine work. You know, then every work becomes divine work. Why? Because I'm not doing it for my own selfish motives. I'm doing it because this feels right. And whatever feels right, of truth, there we connect back to our inner truth. So although along with that, parallelly, you're right that we need to have a lot of space in our life for reflections, for contemplations. But the more and more we become ready for it, the more work must be there in our life, done as an offering, you know, offering to the divine. We have hands for a reason. We have ears and feet for a reason. So again, as we were all saying, you know, all of you said kind of a moderation somewhere. And Mother says that when we really get in touch, when we let the psychic in front, when we get more and more in touch with our deeper inner truth in each moment, that balance becomes very natural. One does not have to calculate and have that balance. Calculation is the work of mind. One does not even have to go there. Once I am in touch with my inner truth, then I can sleep for 3 hours and still be, my body be fine. So there is no set rigid rule of sleeping for only, you know, these many hours. I remember I read many a times that Mother and Sri Aurobindo did not used to sleep like really, you know, when, you know, like 7-8 hours of sleep. She may have said that to children growing up, right? It's good to have a balance, you know, so sleep well, eat well and all that. But Sri Aurobindo and Mother herself, they were really, because their minds were on a higher mission, they were able to be active throughout for this mission. Many a time Sri Aurobindo would have dinner at really very late, you know, and that did not matter, because what matters is where am I right now within. Rest, everything is secondary. So I'm assuming Himanshi will be sharing later, or Himanshi, do you have anything to share right now?
No, I'll share later.
Okay. Okay. So let us then one by one take these lines up. O Lord, master of our life. You know, when I looked at it, you know, I just realized our master is not the Lord. Most of the times our master is my impulsions, my desires, my mind. Where does it want to send me next? That is my master, my feelings. What are they craving for? You know, let me give them the thing that they are craving for, my feelings. You know, these are our masters. No wonder that we feel so confused and lost. And here it's, you know, there is a word called Satyanishth. You know, one who is sticking to truth no matter what. So that the truth is the master of my life. No matter what are the stakes associated. When that happens, you know, that is a beauty that we are striving towards in each and every moment of our lives. O Lord, master of our life, let us soar up high, very high, far above all care of the preservation of the body. You know, we see, if we look at the contents of our mind, they are all obsessed with me and mine and myself. You know, if I am thinking about my child, why am I thinking about him? Because he is my child. You know, if I am thinking about my body, why am I thinking about it? Because it's my body. You know, so this me is so prevalent, and it's kind of, you know, this is dal mein kankad hota hai na, dal mein patthar hota hai, you know, these pulses when we are soaking lentils, we see that there are many times stones. You know, this is like a stone. This meanness attached to everything in my life. And that's why it becomes so, so heavy and burdensome. Remove the meanness. And we just are left with the factuality. So, for example, I get a symptom in the body. And I'm really continuously thinking about it, viciously in my head. I see that I'm just obsessed with me and my body, my body, my body, what will happen to my family, my child, my child. And the moment I remove the my from these sentences, I see that, okay, there is a body which needs attention, which may have to go to the hospital because this is happening. You know, there is a child who needs attention and because he's hurt himself or whatever. You know, so we remove 80-90% of the complication is removed, and what we are left is with the factual reality. This has happened and this is to be attended. So can we notice this? Can we notice the source of our heaviness and burdens? And maybe try to lighten it up, because it's in our hands. We have given it the burden. And mother, you know, later talks that nothing more depressing than these thoughts turned away, turned always towards the preservation of the body. And always obsessed by the preservation, you know. And the thing is that, you know, I often ask myself, even if I want to save myself, what on earth am I doing worthy that I should save myself? I often ask myself this question. And if I'm really doing something worthy, is there not the divine presence who will guide me to how to save if the body has to be saved? Why so much obsession with this saving of myself? You know, if we look at the Milky Way, the galaxy, if you look at where Earth and solar system is, they're not even visible if the whole Milky Way comes in front of us. If you look at these pictures by the astronaut, the NASA, you know, it's not even a single dot lost in the magnanimity of all that. And yet, in the moment of a challenge, my difficulty appears like it's really so huge, you know, the illusion that it gives me. So can I just lighten this up? We have to live these lives. We are here for a reason, or maybe not, I don't know. But the one thing that I can do is I see that I can be a little kind towards myself, you know, and that kindness means not to give myself so much of burden of this meanness, the heaviness. You know, the maximum worst that can happen is I will go away, I will pass. So people pass away, people go away. What is such a big deal about it? Why should any condition of the body be a cause of fear and anxiety for us? Yeah. This preoccupation with health, with our substance, subsistence, with the framework of life. You know, if, as Shilpi was also sharing, you know, we just change the subject of our obsession. We just don't do much change there. You know, earlier I was obsessed with my relationships. Earlier I was obsessed with, you know, what is going on in the earthly domain. Now I am obsessed with the health. This has to be eaten, that has not to be eaten. You know, do we actually take care also in terms of our mind? That this thought must be thought and that thought must not be thought. You know, apne se bhi kuch agar hum seekh le le, even if we kind of take a little bit of learning from there. You know, how beautifully we take care of our houses. We spend so much of time on that. Decluttering, Diwali pe karni hi karni hai safai. Kya har Diwali pe hum mind ki bhi safai karte hai? Diwali to chodo, you know, pura saal nikal jata hai. Whole year goes by and the mind gets on getting cluttered and cluttered and cluttered forever. So we have this obsession with the gross. And the subtler we can be sensitive to our subtle movements, we will see that even that obsession can help us. How? Because I see that I declutter my room. Can I also declutter my mind? Because I see that these patterns are not helping me. These worries and anxieties are not helping me. And anyway, things are not in my control. So can I just do what is right in this moment? And in this moment, what feels right is, has always to be right. You know, what is light is right. The moment heaviness comes, I can be sure that I am falling into a trap. So saying again, rejection, you know, rejecting, as mother says, rejecting going into that heaviness. There is nothing juicy there. And then Alok Da here shares, you know, beautiful story of Indra and Virochana, where they go to the Brahma and they ask, what is the true self? You know, what is self? And Indra is not satisfied. He keeps on questioning and questioning. You know, this is what is so beautiful. You know, questioning and questioning, questioning and questioning, not settling down with a satisfactory reply. No matter, it may have been given by our gurus, our masters. Even then we have to question it. Is it true for me? Mother may have said this, but do I feel this happens with me? And mother herself says, you know, like a scientist, you do parikshan, you know, experimenting with your own life. Does it help you? And keep only that helps us. And remove all that which is not helping anymore. It may have helped in the past. And here, you know, Indra discovers that when we discover this immutable peace and the true self, a connection with that inner light, then it also lends the health of the body. So there is no need to have a separate preoccupation with the body. That, okay, the mind and feelings are really dirty. I don't care about that. And only then I need to have a separate care of the body. Why? Because when mind and emotions make a lot of ruckus, they manifest themselves in the body. The body is the last layer in which the ruckus of mind and feelings come, manifests. So can I go to the root of the health of the body? Before the disease appears in the physical body, it has already appeared in mind and feelings. Can I become more sensitive to that? Can I hit the root of the disease? And then I will not need any preoccupation with the body because I have directly hit at the root. You know, there was this talk, you know, there was a session that I was a part of, and they were talking about diseases like cancer and healing and all that. And, you know, she asked me, the moderator was asking me, okay, what is the suggestion you want to give to people, you know, about the health and maintaining the health of the body and all that. And I said, the biggest immunity that one can have is being in touch as much as in our capacity with our truest truth, you know, with our innermost being. That is the biggest immunity one can have. Otherwise, all this preoccupation with the body is nothing but allopathy. You know, we have a headache. You don't see the root of the headache. You just suppress the symptom of the headache. The root is still there. You know, your husband might have given you a headache, or the thought about your husband may have given you a headache, but you took a crocin and all fine. So can I look why on the first place I had this headache? Because I was viciously thinking about this person in my life, which I don't need to. And then even crocin will be unnecessary. Why to waste money on crocin? Why to make the body go through the side effects of crocin? So this is what I feel, you know, I personally feel hitting at the root is always so beautiful because it's also revelatory in nature. You know, it reveals something new to us. A new part of us is revealed to us in hitting at the root. Yeah. Feel free to share in between. Yeah. Yes, and then Alokda is sharing. How an animal does not keep on running. The animal is centered in the body. You know, if you see the animal instincts, and they're all bodily instincts. And the good thing with animals is that they don't go overboard. You know, they will not overeat. They will not oversleep. So being in touch with their nature, which is Prakriti, their nature is Prakriti. They are in tune with, they're in alignment. That is the highest they can go. But for human beings, our center is not the Prakriti. We have a Prakriti. Our center is the Atman, is the Self. And that is why we feel so, so lost when we are either identified with the mind or with the feelings or with the physical body. We feel lost. We feel abandoned. We feel confused, cluttered all the time. We want to fill up this void, and we think that we'll fill up this void by eating more, having more relationships in life, having more good friends. But even that, when good friends are away, I feel that void again. So can I see, really look at the root of the issue? And that then takes me away or detaches me from overindulgence or obsession with either the body or the mind or feelings. All the creators of misery, then I am kind of spaced out from, you know, I'm detached from them. How trivial are these things? A thin smoke dissolved by a simple breath, vanishing like mirage before a single thought turned towards thee. Now, this is really beautiful. This actually talks about power of free will. No matter how many murders may have done in my ignorance, no matter how bad the day was so far for me in my ignorance, no matter how heavy the day was so far for me, the moment I choose to turn my thought toward the divine, I am free of all that burden. You know, there's a knowing has to be there that nothing, all that is a constant trap that will remain. And I can either choose to be there in the trap or I can choose to be here with the mother. And mother will guide whatever resolution is to be found about that worldly situation. Mother will guide. The right action will be done. And then everything else, the heaviness dissolves like a smoke, you know, as if it was not even there. As light it becomes. But if I continue to remain in my confusion and trying to find a resolution there, it's assured that the heaviness will remain even after an action has been taken from arising from the confusion. Heaviness will remain. That's assured. It may just disappear for some time, but it will come again. While an action done at the feet of the mother, the action taken from a silent mind, the action taken from a clear mind, a simple mind, that guaranteed will take me towards more and more peace and clarity. So very simple. It seems so simple that many a times the mind fails to notice it, because the mind loves complications. You know, if there was a course done on how to turn your thoughts from negative to positive, there is a formula. No, most people will be so attracted to it. Oh, there is a formula. I want to learn that formula. Here is a formula right in up front of us. How to dispel all these thoughts? By simply turning our thoughts towards the divine. Nothing else. But here, there is a catch. If I turn my thoughts to the divine, this means I will have to rest my case. The ego will have to rest the case. And that is where we get trapped again. We don't want to lose. The ego doesn't want to lose. So in order to win, I keep myself in the confusion for a longer time. Because so far I have not won. And maybe in future I will win this argument. So to show that I am worthy, to show that I also have power and, you know, calculative mind, I will remain in this confusion so far the result, the desired result is not achieved. And this is how we prolong our miseries. Sometimes for a lifetime, we are not ready to give up. The ego is not ready to give up. It wants to prove itself right. And here, when I turn away from that confusion and chaos, saying I have nothing to do with that confusion, I want to be in this simplicity, I don't give fuel through the ego. I'm happy to be wronged. I'm happy to be alienated. All I value is this truth and simplicity. Pay the price. It's a very, very cheap price. It's very cheap price. Kabir talks about striking the right bargain. This is the right bargain. Give everything away to have proximity with the truth. Sachcha Sauda, Kabir says, you know, the right bargain. Kabir says that I have done the right bargain. Now you also do if you want to have a simple life.
Yeah.
Yes. And this is really beautiful. You know, I experiment with this in my own life, and I would like to really stress on this. Here, Alokda is sharing that instead of, you know, being absorbed in that confusion, here, you know, it may be difficult for the people to meditate and contemplate all the time, but we can at least read something or pick up an idea to explore that we have computers. You know, now Alokda shares that instead of being absorbed in that confusion, what we can do, how to turn our thoughts to the divine, you know, listen to a talk which is elevating. A self-forgetfulness is very, very necessary, because wherever there is I-ness, a strong I-ness, we can be sure that the confusion and heaviness will remain. So what we have to do, we have to let go of that I-ness. That I-ness will remain for as long as we are alive. But we don't have to give so much of fuel to the I-ness. Let it remain like a fly or spider lives in my house. Let it remain. I don't have to give much fuel to it. I have to do what feels right to me. Now, how do I utilize these moments of life? What is the best that I can do in these moments? Read something, begin something new, you know, learn a skill, offer your time to some volunteer work or maybe a job. I don't know, anything which feels right. So when we pick up an idea, you know, a high idea, and we reflect on it, maybe write our thoughts, write a poem on it or anything, or words full of light and consciousness by great masters, you know, then we see that I-ness that was making the situation appear so heavy, then that I-ness dissolves and we are absorbed in a self-forgetfulness. And there I realized that everything, all the heaviness was originating from the I-ness in my life, me and my life. So self-forgetfulness, self-abnegation is very important. It's very paradoxical, actually. So at the same time, we have to keep on working on ourselves, but also not to be obsessed by ourselves.
Okay, yes. So I'm going through something, with confusion here.
Sure.
For whatever reason that I left Delhi and I came to Canada, that is one side. That time I was either busy in a little ashram. मुझे तो मदर ने उठा के जैसे बिल्कुल ना सारे काम छोड़ के बिल्कुल विल्ला कर दिया, यू नो, उठा के ऐसे प्लॉप कर दिए कमरे में एक जगह में. पर यहाँ पे भी ऐसे प्लॉप कर दिया कि नाउ प्रीति लर्न कुकिंग, ओके, सिट हियर प्रीति, लर्न टू इवन व्हेन यू आर एक्सरसाइजिंग डू इट वेल और यू नो विद मोर अवेयरनेस. और व्हेन आई डोंट नो मुझे क्यों उठा के ऐसे कर दिया. In fact, I'm totally alone and with a lot of time. And yes, definitely reading, contemplation, and yes, having joined you, and I'm coming back on track on reading and listening. To my beech mein bahut miss ho gaya tha a few years ke liye, because I was just running around either just to do a little ashram mein seva, jaise I was teaching there, and or I was just doing my RWA work, or yeah, colony mein kuch kaam karna hai bachchon ke saath. Physical calm was more than thinking, you know, maybe for some clarity, she's just picked me up and now.
Beautiful.
I hope it is that only. And, you know, ki now I'm thinking and I'm questioning and jaise ek wo onion ki layer nahi utarte rehte hain. So that kind of a feeling is coming. Okay, achha, ab ye baat samajh mein aa gayi.
Achha, theek hai.
I hope it is just that only.
Preeti, when you are saying, I hope it is just that, just stay with this sentence.
Yeah. So what else can be there? Because I don't want to fall in INS, because, you know, then I feel like another kind of thinking and feel like it's going to happen. You know, that is what I'm... So this prayer is a good reminder.
So there is something called a kuvichar, and there is something called a suvichar. So there is, I don't know how to translate into English, Chitraji, I'm sorry. So kuvichar may be something like a bad thought, but I don't think it's the exact Hindi English version. And suvichar is something which a bright, maybe I can say bright thought, okay? The thought full of light. So when you are saying, Preeti, that I hope I don't get stuck in I-ness, you know, when you are now seeing more, learning more about yourself, and as you said, you know, peeling as if layers after layers of yourself and understanding it. Hota kya, you know, when the knowledge is half, when the knowledge is a kuvichar, it sticks to the mind. It makes the mind heavy that, okay, the mind is having a lot of knowledge. But when the knowledge is true, it's a knowing, when the knowledge is pure, it's light, there is a property of that kind of a thought. What that does is, so it comes into your system, it does all the cleansing that it has to do. And along with that, that thought also evaporates. The knowledge also evaporates. That is a sign which you can use, I would say. If the present phase in any of the days, you know, where you are reflecting and contemplating, if that reflection and contemplation leaves you feeling that, oh my God, I have like a lot in my head, you can be sure that that is not a suvichar. A suvichar will be not leaving you heavy. It does its work and it sublimates itself. So when I am understanding deeper and deeper layers of my own self, don't think that I will now begin to write a Gita, I'll keep in my head that, you know, okay, these are the layers of myself. Those are not needed because you are mobile ashram, jaise kehte hai na, you are the chalta firta thing, you know, the whole knowledge is in you. So when you are saying that, I hope it doesn't become a burden, I think I wanted to stay with that, because if it is becoming a burden, if it's becoming an obsession also, then also it must be looked at.
That's what I said. It's a nice जी, reminder.
जी, जी, बिल्कुल, बिल्कुल. Yeah.
So I understand them. But yes. Saying in Tamil also like that, yeah. What you said, I understood fully, yes.
Okay, great. Yeah, so this is one, this beautiful idea of turning the thoughts to the divine. I'll do that. I personally, that's why I wanted to stress on this, that whenever a life situation is becoming heavy in my life, what I do is I pick my work. I pick my work up, and the work is so liberating that after 1 hour of being immersing in the work, that problem itself disappears as if it was a previous life. You know, so all the memory is also erased. You know, what was it that I was, so burdened about? I don't even remember that. And that's so beautiful. You know, if one can give ourselves to such kind of a reading or contemplation or work, that the problems just sublimate. They don't have that much of hold over us. That's really something to be experienced. Yeah. And then Mother prays for all of us. Liberate those who live in this slavery. You know, and here Alokda is sharing that we are slaves of our own nature. How strongly do I stick to my image? You know, I am Monica and this is who I am. This is who I have been for years now. And I want to preserve that. This is the biggest slavery. And Gita, Alokda here gives a reference of Gita. You know, our self is the friend of the self and self is the enemy of the self. So I am fueling my own fear. I am fueling my own I-ness. And if I want, I can turn all the fuel towards the thoughts, towards the divine, liberating thoughts, or I can continue fueling the I-ness. What do I want to do? It may appear like a doing. It may appear like a personal effort. But it's all, everything is immersed and soaked and drenched in divine grace. Although it may appear that I have to do, because one has to get off from inertia, tamas, and take this step that, yes, enough of it, enough of misery. I don't want to fuel this I-ness anymore. I want to do something which elevates me, which brings me higher and higher from those low-lying areas. Because those low-lying areas will always remain. What I can do is I can create beauty even being there. And then hence transform those low-lying areas also. So giving all the energy towards the discovery of this self. It's the inner discovery. But when it is opposed to it, creating doubts, fears, all kinds of distressing situations, you know, then it becomes an enemy, this self, you know. So I am the one who is fueling either the rediscovery of inner discovery, as Preeti was sharing, you know, the peeling of layers and layers and layers. That can be a beautiful journey. Or I take myself too personally and then feel victimized and guilty and all that blame game, you know, that one that can just go on and on. Liberate those who live in this slavery, even as those who live in slavery to their passions. You know, I can think that I have a free life. I am doing what I want to do. But actually, I am also just a slave to my passions. So can we question it? Can we really question that, do I have the real freedom or am I just a slave to my passions now? How do I get the real freedom? Does that even exist? No, questioning all that. These obstacles on the path that lead towards thee are at once terrible and puerile. Now, what are the obstacles Alokda shares here? A preoccupation with the bodily sustenance and the slavery to passions and slavery to physical existence. And these obstacles, Mother shares, are at once terrible. Terrible for those who are going through it. If I am drenched in a confusion and chaos, it really feels terrible. I feel there is no way out. Everything appears so dark. And puerile for those, you know, childish for those who have gone past it. How do I go past it? Immediately turn towards the divine. Don't give it attention. The right action will come if it has to come. And then it really appears childish. Oh my God, you know, where I was stuck? Where was I stuck? Was it even necessary? But maybe it was necessary. Maybe I needed to go through that experience. You know, all the experiences in our lives, they just always have this beauty about them. They always show us something new, if one is ready to see that newness. And then it appears really childish, you know, ki how on earth was I stuck there where I was stuck a couple of days ago or 2 years ago or 3 years ago. Then it may appear childish. Terrible to those who are still subjected to them and puerile to those, to one who has passed beyond them. How inexpressible is this utter sense of relief, the delicious lightness, you know, delicious lightness, as if you can taste it even. And as Shilpi was sharing, we all have tasted that. It's not possible that we have not tasted that. It may be a different thing that we, in our ignorance, chose not to stay with it. But we all have a taste for it. And that is why we crave for this lightness when we are burdened with the heaviness. You know, we crave, we want to be light again. And that is the very sign that we must have tasted it. How on earth do I know that lightness exists? How inexpressible is the utter sense of relief, the delicious lightness we feel when we are disembarrassed of all this anxious care for ourselves, for our life, for our health, for our satisfactions, and even for our progress. You know, even for our spiritual progress. To be light is this. To be at the feet of Mother is this delicious lightness. What does a slave want more than the feet of the Lord? But the very fact that I find myself again and again wanting more and more tells me that there is more I can do to be a better slave. Because I see that the mind runs and I run after the mind. Abhi ye nahi mila, wo nahi mila. This is experience I have not got. This relationship has not got perfected. That has not got perfected. As if I know the best. So once I have the feet of the Lord, why do I care? For progress, for my life, for my health, for my accomplishments, for my even my children. Why would I care? Because if I call it my child, you know, first of all, we all are children of the divine. So in that sense, we are all equals. So would divine take more care of one child than the other? That is not possible. So can I leave also to the divine the excessive anxiety and the worries that we do about our own children? We may do the right action that may be needed for our children, but why to excessively worry? Is the divine not guiding? Do I know better than the divine? You know, this anxiety is also very egoistic anxiety, because anxiety tells me that I know better. My ego knows better than the divine. What the divine plan is, maybe a really rubbish plan. So I need to get on my high guard and create a plan for my future, because the divine has no clue. So this anxiety and worry just tells us about an inflated sense of an I-ness again. Yeah. Yes. Another place, Mother says, if you think only about yourself, your life surely will be miserable. You know, this is really beautiful. This is really beautiful. And I think this also gives us a clue that if I am going through a misery, it definitely is a misery where the root is me and myself. Can I immediately abandon that? That can be done. Immediately turn your thoughts towards something higher, which liberates, which sublimates this heaviness. As long as the I-ness remains, the miseries will remain. One thing I can do, which is in my hands, is not to give fuel to my miseries. Because when I give fuel to my miseries, the whole day I'm talking and thinking about my misery only. You know, jaise kehte hai na, rai ka pahad, you know, a mole, a mountain out of a mole hill. Exactly that. So when I am going through a misery, we can be really sure that there must be the root of I-ness in that misery. See it, let it sublimate, don't give it fuel. Yeah. This delicious lightness we feel when we are free of all this care for ourselves, our life, our health, even our progress. You know, how much I have progressed. I have been on this path for so many years, you know. But I see myself here or there, you know, all that calculation. The calculation is the domain of the mind. As long as I need to sit on a shop and do the calculation, then it is fine. But regarding spiritual progress, regarding my own life's progress, you know, I don't even know the scale on which to calculate it. How can I calculate? There's no need to calculate when the feet of the Lord are next to me. Yes, then this example, this relief, this liberation thou hast granted to me. O divine master, life of my life, light of my light. So beautiful. Yes. You who are the origin of all my intelligence, you who are the breath of my life, by whose force I live, you have granted me this liberation, you know, this liberation from preoccupation, obsession with myself. And then this beautiful story of Amrita, you know, this, I really found it so beautiful, where mother is asking, you know, Amrita, what do you want for the birthday? And people are saying, you know, why didn't you ask mother, grant me transformation, grant me this and grant me that, some spiritual progression. And Amrita is so, you know, as we read earlier, like a slave, that he says that I am at the feet of the mother, and how do I know whether I deserve this liberation or not? Why would I want that? I am with mother, that is enough for me. So mother was asking, and I asked for two banyans. You know, that is so funny and amazing, you know, really. Yeah. Thou who ever teachest me the lesson of love and hast made me know the reason of my existence. What is the reason of our existence? You know, if we just keep that in our head, if we anyway have to keep anything in our head, you know, just that, you know, just this continuous discovery and rediscovery and continuous evolution, you know, then why would we fear any outer external movement or situation in the world? Why would we fear that? Because when the purpose of me being here is to attain more and more union with my truth and to live my truth out, for continuous evolution, for continuous progression, then why on earth would I be scared? Even when illness strikes, or even when a relationship breaks, even when my child leaves me, why would I be afraid? The very fact that I am afraid when these things happen, tell me that I have put the anchor of my inner self there in outer situations. So can I just look at this anchoring? Can I change my anchoring? The reason of my existence. Continuous progression is the reason of our existence. Continuous expansion. Learning, unlearning, this complete journey. So many things to be transformed, so many things to be done. But we are not in a hurry. But yet we are in a hurry because time is limited. We have a human life. Human life so far is limited life. So why to waste it in frivolities? You know? Why not do what feels right and bear the results, bear the side effects? This discovery of the psychic being, mother shares here, you know, Alukda shares, you know, yeah. Once we know what is the aim of our life, how does anything else matter? And then Savitri's lines. Obedient to a high command, she sat. Time, life and death were passing in incidents, obstructing with their view her sight. You know, when Savitri, when Satyavan went away, and Savitri is really, and the Savitri is shown how a human being goes through a loss of a loved one. She's actually drenched in a grief, in deep sadness. And then a voice calls her up. It awakens her up to what is the mission in this life. And that voice directs her to find her psychic being. And she plunges in her being. And then makes a connection with that. So she does go through that human sadness that we go through when we lose our loved one. But can we use the pain? Can we use that pain, the intensity of that suffering, to plunge deeper in our being and to unite with that that calls us all the time? And then after she gets a connection with the psychic, then she goes on, you know, meeting death and, you know, having that dialogue in the further story. She gets the strength to go on. So have we done that? Have we all found our psychic being? How can we rest if we really listen to the mother? There is, you know, look at those points, the 11 points that mother shares on the discovery of the psychic being. Even if we were to follow those 11 points, you know, they're so elevating points that even walking on those points is enough for a lifetime. Whether I find the psychic being or not find the psychic being is a different story. The thing is that walking on those 11 points is itself so liberating that a life well lived, you know, one can say, I did what appeared right to me. Yes, Chitra ji.
Yeah, it is very true, Monica. Actually, I already told you, no? When I faced a lot of problems in the family and all, one day I prayed intensely to mother, why these things are happening? The answer came like, yes, why are you concentrating on these problems? This is the great opportunity to go inside and find out the inner truth. After that, all this, yeah. This is other than that, which you would think that great opportunity. Only these problems and crises would make you to go inside, actually.
Beautiful.
That problem. Answer came, the problem will be solved. No. You find out your inner truth, only this is the correct time to find out. So after beautiful. That, no, it is moving like that only. After this, those healing sessions came, I heard your talk and all those 11 points I noted down and wrote in small papers and did a mala like that and put it in the table, in front of the table. I used to daily practice it, actually. Yeah, really, it is going like that. It's beautiful. True, very true, Monica, really.
Yeah, yeah. Share, really. Yeah, thanks for sharing, yes.
Monica, did you share the points with us on the email?
Email? I don't remember sharing group? It on the email. No, no.
Kar do, please.
Haan, haan, bilkul. Haan? I think I shared it on the WhatsApp group. I'll share it again. Yeah.
Yeah, thanks.
Yes, yes. Yeah, so Alok Dahiya shares that we should not be preoccupied with all that is happening outside. It is all right to be aware, you know. He is also referring to the coronavirus situation that, you know, everybody is so pre-obsessed with, you know, that we may not get sick and all that, you know, all the health challenges. It is all right to be aware, but not all right to be obsessed and possessed by it. And then comes something very, very beautiful. Mother teaches us about the way to live. It is thou who livest in me and thou alone. And why should I be preoccupied with myself and what may happen to me? You know, when you are living through me and you are living in me, who on earth needs to be, you know, obsessed about what is going to happen? It's only the ego that needs obsession. Because the ego wants to, you know, ego has this, the very fact that I am unworthy, I will want to prove that I am worthy and worthy and worthy. So the very fact that the ego is an illusion, although for us it doesn't appear like an illusion, you know, the ego would want to just keep on living this illusion forever. And only in the light of the inner truth, that illusion gets dissolved. So that light of the touch of the inner being, the touch of the innermost presence, is so, so important for each one of us. And the very fact that we have not been touched, been in touch with that, is the present state of the world that we live in, full of misery and, you know, really horrible things going everywhere. So this is very urgent, most urgent than anything in life, that we always walk on this path of inner discovery. Whether we get in touch with the psychic being, whether it comes out forward or not, is a different idea altogether. Those 11 points are just enough to keep us connected to that. Just enough. So Alok Dahi is sharing, what a glorious grand trunk road of freedom from all care and preoccupation. Once I've handed over my life to the divine, then it's up to him. The destiny is no more ours. Does a slave keep questioning the master? Yeah. Yeah, on this I wrote down this doha, you know, from Kabir. Kabir says, Kabir kutta ram ka motiyan mera naam, dori lagi prem ki jit khinche tit jaun. So Kabir says that I am the dog of Ram, of truth, of that inner truth, inner light. I am a dog. A dog is loyal, you know, extremely loyal to the Lord. I am a dog of the Lord within. And I am attached to the Lord with the thread of love. Wherever he pulls me, there I go. Whether it's a confusion he wants me to go through, or whether it's an outer challenge he wants me to go through, I go there. But I don't leave his thread of love. You know, that kind of a slavery. And then each and every challenging outer situation becomes something, some raw material for our own growth, you know, when we have this attitude. Yeah. Yes. Without thee, the dust constituting this body which is striving to manifest thee would be dispersed, shapeless and inconscient. Without thee, this sensibility which opens to us a relation with all these other centers of manifestation would vanish in an obscure inertia. You know, have you looked at a dead body very closely? You know, as if it's nothing, it's amounting to nothing. Just like a piece of rock if it has solidified in time. And I personally remember, you know, a close touch with the dead body of a relative. And I remember that, you know, it's nothing, you know, it's amounting to nothing. The the thing is that the light that shines through it, can we be in touch with that light? You know, when mother shares that you are that which is holding everything together, you are giving vitality to this body. Who am I without you? No, without thee, the dust constituting this body is which is striving to manifest thee would be dispersed, shapeless and inconscient. So this, Alokda shares, should be the true purpose of the body, if the body even has to be taken care of. What is the true purpose? A instrument to manifest the divine, you know, to be in direct touch with the truth within, to manifest it out in our day-to-day actions. What am I feeling right to do in this moment? What feels right? What feels in the welfare of the others and me? The welfare means the deepest welfare, not the welfare of the ego. We usually tend to the welfare of the egos of our relationships. So the egos keep on striving and striving forever. But what feels right? What is the right action to be done so that I remain in my truth and they are also hence directed towards their own truth? Not massaging each other's egos. And then even our relationships, you know, have the possibility of transformation. But we dare not do that, because the very fact that we want to preserve our own identities, our own egos, we don't want to get hurt. We say, okay, rehne dena, you know, usko bhi kyun bole. And that is how we keep on compromising on manifesting truth. Without thee, this thought which animates and throws its light on the synthesis would be diffuse, toneless, unrealized. Without thee, the sublime love which vivifies, which coordinates, which animates, which gives warmth to all would remain an unawakened possibility. So Mother is just showing us all is a manifestation of divine grace. Everything. Can we also go there? We don't have any control over our breath. Who is running our breath? It's going on continuously. Who is in charge? Doesn't he know the best? And then also this talk about intelligence, you know, that the light of on the synthesis will be diffused, toneless, unrealized. The intelligence that we have, the capacity of understanding, the capacity of questioning ourselves, that is also a reflection of the divine grace only. Can we use that more and more towards our own growth? Without the divine, even love is not awakened. No? What we are involved in day-to-day relationships is attachment, you know. And wherever attachment is, love will not be there, because love is freedom. Love is synonymous with strength. Love is synonymous with giving wings to each other. Love is synonymous with limitlessness. And can we look at our own love that we call as love? Without thee, all is inert, brute, or inconscient. Thou art all that illumines and enchants us, our sole reason for existing and our whole aim. Now, Mother is just going to the root of our human existence. Without thee, everything is inconscient. The divine love was sent, the divine sent to bring the inconscient to the consciousness. How much are we collaborating in that? Thou art all that illumines and enchants us, our sole reason for existing and our whole aim. Yeah. And Mother, you know, again, this reminded me of one Kabir Doha. Kabir shares, Ram mile thane kaun hatke. You know, once you find the truth. Once you have got, the truth has got you. Who can stop you? Who on earth can stop you from following the path of truth? And the very fact that I am stopped on the way by following the path of truth tells me that truth hasn't yet got me. I am still in falsehood. Because once I have the truth, I will not be afraid to take the right step ahead. Ram mile thane kaun hatke? Who can stop? Yeah.
And also this last para, no? It is thou who livest in me, thou alone.
Yeah.
This actually, yeah, this is one of the, I think, Alukda's talks I heard. Whenever any, I mean, you want to pray, you can tell that only Lord alone exists, Mother alone exists.
Yeah.
So that, yeah, this last para fully reminded of me that prayer actually. Only beautiful. Lord and Mother.
Yes, yes. Yeah. Is that not enough to cure us of all personal thoughts? Cure us, you know, Mother uses this word as if it's a disease, you know, and it's actually a disease. You know, this occupation with oneself is so much of a disease. Is that not enough to cure us, Mother says, to cure us of all personal thoughts? So indirectly, Mother wants to say that it is all actually an illness. You know, we are afraid of a physical illness. We are actually going through an illness. This illness, this disease of being obsessed with ourselves. Beautiful. Yeah. Is that not enough to cure us of all personal thoughts and to make us unfurl our wings and soar above the contingencies of the material life, so that we can fly up into thy divine atmosphere with the power to return? Now, Mother is not stopping there, that we can fly up into thy divine atmosphere and just stay there. Mother is not stopping there. We can fly up into thy divine atmosphere with the power to return as messengers to the earth and announce the glorious tidings of thy advent, which is near. Now, this is our task. This is the task allotted to us for which we have to collaborate. Go into that, fly high into that immersion into the divine, and then bring that out in the day-to-day acts. Now, for that, one thing which is very important is, for example, maybe I was a murderer, right? Maybe I am a murderer. I am a really a criminal person. And now I'm changing my pattern. So I'm going up, flying up high in the divine presence, and now turning back on the earth as a messenger and trying to manifest that divinity into my actions. Now it cannot be that I will continue doing the same work which I was doing earlier in my ignorance. So if we want to say that if I was into a job or a family or a relationship which is toxic and now I am changing, it cannot be that I get strength to stay in that relationship, to continue the misery. Many a times it is necessary to break out of it. So many a times I need now to leave the job of being a murderer because that doesn't feel right. It does not mean that I continue doing what now doesn't appear right. Right? So when we are asking for strength, you know, Mother, give me strength. Mother, please show me the way. Mother will show you the way, but will you listen? Mother will say, hey, enough of these many years of this relationship. Now go, you know, live your own life. But it'll tremble me. I will shiver because I will have to change a complete identity. That relationship now doesn't appear right. So this is what is the breakage of old identities, old patterns, you know. I cannot imagine that I go to the divine, I immerse in the divine, and now with the divine truth shining out of me, I do the murder again. But now I can say, yes, I am doing the murder, but now the divine is with me. You know, one has to change the job. one has to change the relationship. One has to maybe completely find a new identity. And the very fact that I do not gain strength in my life for taking the right action is because I do not allow myself to take the right action. I want strength for a stupid action. I'm saying, mother, I'm living in misery. Give me strength to remain in misery. And mother is not giving you strength. Because mother doesn't want us to remain in misery. And that's why we never get that kind of a strength to continue, you know, this miseries of either toxic relationships or, you know, anything in the world. Or sticking to a job which does not now appeal to me. You know, even jobs has to be changed. You know, my transformation is happening. I am evolving as a person. Now the job that I was doing for past 20 years does not appear right to me. And what am I doing? I am asking the mother the strength. Mother, please give me strength to do this job. Mother is giving you strength, but this job now cannot continue. So mother is giving you strength to pick up another thing. Leave it. Leave which is not aligned with your truth. Now that is really very urgent to attend. That we don't need to continue our miseries and ask strength to go through those miseries, right? Yeah. O divine master, sublime friend, marvelous creature, in a fecund silence, I salute thee. Yeah. And the divine here, Alukda shares, you know, he does not necessarily teach through words. He teaches us through the pregnant silences in which he pours his light. You know, when we are really going through painful situation, difficult challenges, as Chitraji was sharing, you know, there we really get into the depths of our being. That gives us a chance to touch those depths which we never dared to traverse. There he pours his light, his message, his vision, his truth. And then they begin to translate as words in our mind and in thoughts and in speech and also in action. Yeah.
And also in somewhere he shares, no, that relationship will become newer ones. I mean, with those people who are in the same divine vibrations, those will be connected. In some
way, yeah. He shares, yes.
Then yes. It reminded of us actually.
True. I think this is really strange that we think that the blood, because the owing to the fact that we are so occupied with the body, we think we are the body. That, you know, we also keep on sticking to our blood relations. You know, and we prolong our misery by saying that, oh my God, this is my blood relation and this is where I should be. And that is reflecting just our obsession with the body. Because if I am the true self that I am, then I can be with everyone equally. Not with those four walls in which my blood relations are there, because that is really egoistic. Yeah. Yes. Any thoughts? Anyone?
Alokda ki bhi jo baatein hain, wo ek prayer hi ban gayi hai.
Bilkul.
It seemed like one.
Very true. Prayer. Very true. Yeah. Very true. I think what really reflects out of his sharings is, you know, his love for the mother. You know, it's really amazing. Yeah. It always reflects. Yeah. What were you saying?
Last mein aapne wo word dala na, action. As yeah. Words in our mind and thoughts and speech.
Yeah.
Action yeah. Would be the byproduct.
Bilkul.
I think, yeah. That's why he's not put it there.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Himanshi, any thoughts? You didn't share in the beginning. Okay, I think she's maybe not there.
No, oh, yeah. I was trying to unmute myself.
Okay, okay.
I couldn't find.
You like to share? Yeah.
I'm kind of, it's been an eye opener today, and I'm, processing all that what I've heard today. Yeah.
Okay. Great.
Yeah,
great.
A lot of thoughts have come, but nothing much to share. But yes, I have. Yeah.
Taken. Beautiful. Thank you
for this prayer. Yeah. Thank you for sharing all this.
Yeah, Shilpi, you would like to share?
Yeah, Monica. Actually, I had a question. So I feel like I really connected to what you were saying also, and the prayer also. But I had this question that in the beginning, when Mother says, you know, she talks about that how depressing it is when suddenly we find that, oh, for such a long time, all my thoughts have been related to the body or this or that desire or, you know, whatever. Yeah. I think I have been lost in that for a long time. So when I was reading that, it just occurred to me that when I try to follow that chain, you know, that who is the one that is so lost in this? Who is the one that wants it so earnestly? You know, like you talked about the child, about family, or about some other material desire, right? And then it is very hard to follow it to the end. You know, follow that into the end. Like, end pe kaun hai? Jisko sab ye sab chahiye, chahiye, chahiye. And who basically, you know, this... like people say that our natural state is not this, no?
But
something or somebody, I don't know whether it is a somebody or it is just a bunch of desires that are always taking that away, you know, taking us out into kind of a jungle, basically.
Beautiful.
So I just wanted to share this and also ask your if you could share your understanding that how does one follow to the end of this this chain to find chal kya raha hai?
Yeah, beautiful. You know, when you say this, the example of Miraj comes to me, and it kind of appears that, you know, I'm trying to touch a mirage. Will I ever be able to do that?
No, we cannot touch it because it's not real, right?
So that is something which came to me, because when you shared, you know, I cannot follow it to the end. The very fact that this is a mirage. Maybe the moment I begin to follow it, I see going on and on and on, and I don't see myself reaching any end. Because that thing which will end. That thing which is only a mirage, how will that have any end? And also, Shilpi, share.
No, Monica, I was just listening. Go on.
Yeah. And also, you know, one thing, also, there are many, many ways of this approaching the same thing, as Alokda was sharing in the middle of the paragraphs, you know, that that following something high, following a higher idea, reading the words of masters and saints and mystics, which kind of take you towards this self-abnegation, which kind of make you forget about this I that is the source of all the issues. So that is one of the things. So one is that one can constantly reflect upon what is the source of the thing, and maybe reach somewhere or not reach somewhere, which you are talking about. The other is to let it be like a fly. To not give it much attention. So if there is a mirage on the road, what will I do? I will not give it much attention.
Yeah.
If there is a fly or spider in my room, I will not be obsessed by it. I'll just keep on doing my worthy work, which is to be done. Maybe cooking for children or maybe writing a book. Let the fly and mosquitoes be there.
So basically that is also like a surrendering only, right, Monica? Like you, instead of you trying to getting frustrated because you're not able to get to the end of it, like how I said
yes,
it.
Yes, yes, yes.
You kind of let it be alone.
Let it be.
Yeah. And then you kind of stop. Stop paying attention sometimes becomes difficult. I mean, sharing honestly, because I feel like it really, really catches my attention.
Bilkul.
Surrendering again and again. I think.
Surrendering again and again, and also giving yourself to something which really absorbs you. That has always helped. You know, giving yourself to, for example, if there is a lizard in my house, okay? Because lizards usually scare people when they are in the houses, right?
Yeah.
So if there is a lizard in the house and I am all by myself and I have not much to do, I will be just trying to shoo that lizard away, you know, till nikal bahar, nikal bahar, nikal bahar. While on the other hand, if something is happening in my house, maybe a celebration going on, maybe some, like lots of people have arrived who I'm attending to, I will say, okay, you know, you keep there, be on the wall wherever you are. I'll attend to you later. Let me finish this important work right now. So just like that, absorbing yourself in something of the higher, you know, which gives us light and clarity and lightness, where this I-ness does not matter. The stories do not matter. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you.
Welcome. Yeah. Okay, great. So thank you, everyone. Thank you for joining in, tuning in, sharing, reflecting together. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Monica.
Thank you. Bye-bye.